Well, good morning, everyone. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge that we meet today on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people and that we do respect our elders past and present, and also people who Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people into the future. We'd like to acknowledge that we meet today on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people. I'm very pleased to be on stage with Rosemary, and it's quite an honour to be here at this point, 1 year in with the Rosemary Bryant AO Research Centre. And I would also like to acknowledge and say thank you to the ANMF for allowing us to give you an overview of where we've come from in the last 12 months, and also to Elizabeth and Rob for their incredible trailblazing innovation around establishing and supporting the development of a nursing and midwifery research centre based in South Australia, but for the future to have a massive potential. I'm just going to give you an overview of what we've done in the last 12 months. And just talk you through some of the activities that we've been doing with the view for you to see what the Research Centre's key drivers are and what the aims are for the future. I'm just going to give you a little bit of a background around what we've been doing, and bearing in mind that we're not just progressing research, but we're also setting up a business in terms of establishing a research centre from scratch. So it has sort of two arms to the work. So it has research themes and objectives as well as business objectives. So the University of South Australia and the ANMF have partnered as founding partners to develop the research centre with a view to be trailblazers for the nation and to connect globally so that we can help to inform knowledge translation and improve clinical outcomes for our patients, and also develop the professional development of nurses and midwives. The strategic innovation and partnership is focused on these four key areas: the nursing midwifery workforce, and I'll explain this a little bit further in a minute, the health system and planning and resources, clinical care outcomes, translation of evidence into practice, which is critical. And I think from a point of view of research that you may do, seeing it translate into practice is one of the greatest benefits of the research that we will be doing. We have developed a steering committee. Rosemary Bryant is the chair, Professor Carol Gretsch from University of South Australia, Elizabeth DeBars from the ANMF, and Rob from the ANMF, and myself. And now we're at the point where we have the steering committee established, and for the next 12 months we'll be forming and building a research subcommittee that will inform the strategic direction of the centre. So the first 12 months we've been building our profile, and days like this is a fantastic opportunity to do that. We've been establishing the brand, so literally establishing a brand. So what does the brand look like? And importantly, we've been developing the strategic plan and the strategy for what's important for nursing and midwifery into the future. We've achieved state, national and international engagement over the last 12 months and built the brand awareness, and that's been through a lot of profiling, meeting and greeting and talking to people around what we're trying to achieve, but also what people are wanting to see from the centre. And we've completed the Rosemary Bryant Research Centre strategic plan, and if you go past the booth, we'll give you a, it's called a SOAP, which is a strategy on a page, a condensed version of what that looks like, and you can have a bit more of an understanding about what we're trying to achieve. We've also had some success with achieving some grant funding, which has been fantastic, and give us an opportunity to sort of build the staff in the team. So 12 months ago, almost to the day, the Rosemary Bryant AO Research Centre was launched at the last ANMF conference. Since then, we've now established a vision, which is to look at a translational nursing midwifery research centre that is facilitating optimal health and welfare of our communities. So a big vision around what we're trying to achieve on a broader scale. And to do this, our mission will be to lead high impact nursing midwifery research and the application of evidence into practice within the healthcare system for the benefit of the community and society. As part of our strategy, we've been building the brand, and we involved designers and brand experts, and we talked to them about what we were wanting to achieve and how we wanted to connect with people. And so you'll see these symbols, and humanity, connectedness and global was what came out of the discussions, and that was really about how do we make sure that we don't lose the true essence of what we're trying to achieve, which is caring and humanity within the profession and the research that we do, how we make sure that we're connected to the real issues and make sure that we're relevant, not just within South Australia, but nationally and internationally. And globally, how can we influence from South Australia building a statewide research initiative to becoming a national initiative to becoming a global influence? We've been able to get some good media coverage over the last 12 months, which has been good for promoting and then people coming to us and approaching us around what we're trying to achieve. We had our launch in February this year, and if you come to UniSA, please do come and say hello. We're on level 4 in the Playford building, and this is the actual glass wall of where we are, and that's the final graphics that was completed. We've now got a team of people, and I'm really pleased to say we also have within our team two PhD students who were both awarded scholarships for the next 3 years. One of them is looking at nurse-led clinics and the importance of understanding how we establish nurse-led clinics and the potential to scale that up and to translate that into different sites. And the other person is looking at patient-reported outcomes, so trying to developed a standardised tool looking at measuring quality of life measures for people who are diagnosed with cancer. We've established 4 themes with 8 research objectives, and I'm just going to touch on them very quickly. We have looked at trying to influence in terms of who we are, and this is not who we are as Rosemary Bryant, but who we are as a whole profession, where we want to go and how we want to influence. One of the important things is to understand where we're at and to look at what we're doing with our workforce now and into the future. What we do, and this is looking at how we influence our care, drive our care and look at clinical practice. So this is really looking at models of care and looking at nurse-led practice and advanced practice nursing. The difference we make, so this is where we actually have the knowledge translation and the influence, and how do we utilise systems within the health system to be able to do that, and how do we do that through new technologies. Everything we've put into the strategic plan has been with a focus of the essence of caring, putting the patient first and the nurse and the midwife as a centre in terms of how do we build the profession. Our future impact is about shaping optimism and making sure that we continue to foster research across the whole gamut of nursing and midwifery from tertiary to primary healthcare. And how do we influence that, and then how do we influence policy through the utilisation of technology, education and research. So our current research activities, and I'll just touch on these briefly, is, and some of you are probably very familiar with the EA, the public sector EA. We're looking at the workforce renewal part of that section at the moment, which focuses on nurses within the workforce, how do we build future capacity, how do we support nurses to transition into retirement, how do we look at mentoring, and how do we make sure that we harness the knowledge and skills of senior clinicians so that we don't lose them when they do retire. So we're doing a review around that. And we're looking at nursing and midwifery-led care. We're trialling a midwifery-led care unit at UniSA, and we've been involved in that. Statewide nursing and midwifery climate survey, which is I'll explain in a minute. And we're also going to survey statewide cancer and palliative care nurses to see how they're trending in terms of burnout, fatigue, change and stress, with a view to be able to look at that across the different areas of nursing and midwifery. We're also supporting the work that the ANMF is doing around best practice guidelines and BPSOs. Patient-reported outcomes is something that is very new within Australia, but we're very focused on trying to understand the patient's journey through the health system and what their quality of life is and how their experience across the health system influences their immediate trajectory of health, but also their long-term outcomes. We focused on governance and clinical practice, and we've been looking at safety and quality and how that influences health service planning and new roles and redesigning healthcare delivery. And the research translation objectives, these are some of the things that you'll see next happening. We were going to launch the Rosemary Bryant Research Fellow Grants, which will be advertised soon. We have the two PhD scholarships. We're hoping to, in the future, have an annual research symposium, which is very heavily weighted to clinician engagement and building a profile around research across the health system. And we aim to inform policy through partnerships. Our business objectives, which is the operational side of the Rosemary Bryant Research Centre, and just touched on that, developing the 5-year strategic plan, looking at obviously ongoing funding to be able to be sustainable for the future, and also supporting the launch of the foundation, which I'm sure that you will hear more about soon. So just in terms of numbers, we've managed to liaise with people at federal level, state level, interstate, different organisations, consumers, clinicians, really to try and understand what people see as important and critical for research in health in the future so that we're absolutely contemporary. And we're pleased to say we have the two PhD students, and we've managed to get $220,000 funding for them for the next 3 years. So our next steps is to launch the strategic plan, which you will see more formally happen in the next few weeks, build our brand profile, support our PhD students, build the engagement strategy, so that's really about how we continue to be contemporary and relevant in the future, and also to build partnerships and collaborations, and also funding opportunities, and importantly, to deliver high quality research. One of the things that you're going to see happen soon is that we will launch through the ANMF a nursing midwifery climate survey. And for everyone in the room, I really hope that you, when you do see this, you send it on to your colleagues, particularly for those people working in the public sector. We want to know how you're trending, how you're tracking, how you're feeling. We want to know across the whole entire networks, that's country as well as metro, acute versus non-acute. We want to know around your willingness to change, how you're feeling from a point of view of burnout, what you're thinking in terms of your future planning around your career. All of those things that people talk about, we want to try and capture and report. And the aim of that is to try and capture a foundation of where everyone is at the moment, and then to be able to resurvey everyone again in 12 months' time. And knowing that we've had so much change from a point of view of transforming health, networks have changed their boundaries, health systems have reformed, bed numbers have gone down, bed numbers have gone up, leadership has changed, there's so much change in every different facet of your working life at the moment. We just want to know how you're going, with a view to be able to see how you're doing again in 12 months' time. This is our website if you want to have a look and see what we're doing. And just in closing, this is our contact details. And now I'm going to hand you over to Rosemary.
Thanks, Marion. Firstly, I'd just like to pay my respects to the traditional owners of the Kaurna land on which we meet today, and pay my respects to their elders past and present. I'd secondly like to thank Rob and Elizabeth and Rob for their vision, as Marion has outlined, in setting this centre up. And the first I heard of it was late July last year, when I had a phone call out of the blue from Rob sort of telling me about it. And you would appreciate, I was recovering from a subarachnoid hemorrhage at the time. I'd been very ill. And it was almost as if it was a dream, this, you know, coming down there, and we want to name the centre after you. And I thought, goodness me. We know what happened. Perhaps I could just say, though, that When I've told my friends and colleagues, particularly overseas, they've said to me, oh, we only do that after you're dead. And it was just a bit ironic because I did actually knock at the pearly gate several times during my illness. I wasn't aware of it, but my family and friends can tell you. It was a bit touch and go there for a bit. But anyway, I am alive and kicking here. So thank you. I mean, it is a great honour to have a research centre named after you, I must say, and I am very grateful. Thank you. So the third thing... Thanks. Thank you. The third acknowledgement is that I'd like to acknowledge the congratulate Marion and her team for the work that they've done thus far. It's been full steam ahead from pretty well the launch or the announcement. The announcement was at August, as Marion's just indicated, last year. And then, of course, the launch earlier this year on the 6th of February. But I think that they're very much on the right track, and each meeting, which, of course, I chair, it's just... I get blown away by the progress and what's happened. So... congratulations, Marion, and the team too. But we live in a time where nursing and midwifery research is more critical than ever before. Around the world, nurse researchers and scholars are asking and answering important questions and adding to our knowledge of health and illness and caring. The work of the researcher improves clinical practice, informs education, influences health service planning, management and policy making, and facilitates advocacy. A commitment to advancing nursing and midwifery research, knowledge development, and the kinds of evidence for different programs is vital to creating a stronger profession. I'm sure you'll all agree with me. We all need to be literate in research methods and the research environment. Over my career, the past 20 years at least, anyway, there have been several attempts to establish a national nursing and midwifery research centre, but none have been successful thus far. This centre is set to become a powerhouse nationally. So, why do I think we've actually nailed it now? Well, the first reason is, Marion has outlined, that this centre will conduct research which is grounded in practice, yet also has an academic rigour, a very happy union producing translational research. Second reason is that while it's a partnership at state level, and that we understand that, it has the full might of the National Australian Nursing and Midwifery Federation behind it. Thirdly, following on from this, it has close ties with the Federal Office of the ANMF, which can, not necessarily behind the scenes, but can also champion its cause. Another very important reason is that it will be independent. And by that I mean independent of government, and particularly government funding. Because as we know, governments can change. There are many calls on their funds or their budget. And with a stroke of a pen, they can withdraw a grant that we might have thought was ongoing, and in fact I have seen that happen at Commonwealth level on several occasions. So we have the advantage of being independent of that threat. And finally, it will have a research committee made up of members whose expertise and contacts are both broad and far-reaching. By this I mean expertise outside the profession. We've been talking about, you know, what sorts of people we want on this research committee, but expertise outside the profession or outside our discipline, and contacts both national and international. So I was very struck when I thought back when I left South Australia and went to work in Victoria, and I, for those of you who weren't around then, and I'm sure there are a lot of you, I went to be the chief nurse in Victoria, and I was very frustrated because it's really easy to get things happening in South Australia. You know, I'd had a pretty easy run with the things I'd wanted to do and the achievements that I had were part of my vision. And to go to Victoria where, oh no, we can't do that, oh, you've got to talk to so-and-so, it was just so much harder. So I think that South Australia has an environment where we want to give things a go. So I'd just like to go through, yes, we do have time, just go through four reasons why we should be supporting this centre. The first and primary reason is because we have an ethical duty to give all patients the best possible care. Today, as we know, knowledge and technology are rapidly advancing, and I had a tour of the new Royal Adelaide last night, and it's like a five-star hotel on steroids almost. It's extraordinary. And having been a patient recently, I'm very aware of the perspective from both the nurse's perspective, and then the perspective from the patient. Our contract with society requires us to seek new information and stay up to date. Using outdated information to care for our patients can cause harm and waste healthcare resources with poor outcomes. We also need to be contemporary so we can discontinue ineffective treatments. And those of you who are not as old as I am might be interested to know that in my youth, there was a brief phase there where Vegemite was used for pressure sores. So I just rest my case on that. And there were other things as well, but Vegemite's the one that, you know, it was very sticky and very messy. Linked to this, the second reason is that we are held accountable for our actions. We all know that. We're expected to use the most recent information as the basis for our clinical decisions. We can all recall practices embedded in our care which have now been abandoned on the basis of evidence refuting their efficacy. In fact, some of these practices were found to be harmful rather than ineffective. So we need to be aware of research findings and their implications for patient care. Researchers have a major role to play in ensuring that research findings are translatable. They must be readily available in a format able to be used by nurses and midwives providing clinical care, as well as those in senior policy positions. It's important to inform both. Clinical nurses and midwives need to ask questions based on pertinent patient care experience that researchers can respond to in a timely fashion. We need to challenge poor practice and replace it with contemporary practice derived from research. Therefore, I would challenge each of you to participate in this overall research process. A third reason to base our practice on research findings is to develop the best and most efficient nursing care possible. Today, we work in a context of healthcare reform, growing public expectations and scarce resources. In response, nurses and midwives need to develop innovative ideas to provide better healthcare in a cost-effective way. Allied, though, to this is the need to ensure that there are sufficient hours of nursing and midwifery, care built into the hospital or healthcare service budget. Whilst I'm preaching innovation and participation and research, there is a threshold of hours per patient which must be reached before any additional activities can occur. Patient care must come first. This is difficult to study, as any estimation depends on many variables, such as context of care, experience of those delivering the care, and patient demographics. Nevertheless, it can be done, and is essential if cogent arguments are to be made to ensure safe staffing. Knowledge is central to good nursing and midwifery care. Good care not only saves lives, it increases access by the community to healthcare, and it saves money. Having hard data is the best way to influence health policy and increase funding for nursing care. It's no good going into politicians. I see some have arrived here this morning for our next session. No point going saying, we think this, we think that, we think something else. We need to have the evidence, the data. They don't really care what you think. They want to look at what will save money and what will influence standards of care. We can use research to prove the value of our work and increase funding for nursing care, and make nursing more visible in society. At this time, we have some way to go to use research to influence health policy and decision making, and Deborah did talk about that yesterday. We need to start from an understanding about how to influence health policy and decision making, and we need to show how care based on research can contribute to achieving health outcomes and the health system redesign aspirations of our governments. Finally, nurses and midwives should base their clinical practice on research findings, because consumers expect us to have the latest knowledge. Many of our patients are sophisticated and well-educated and use the internet or other sources of information to research their symptoms and treatment options. So Marion has shown us this morning that the RB Centre is off to a flying start. I look forward to reporting back to you again next year. Thank you.